Criminally insane means a prisoner who has become mentally ill whilst in the prison system.
This is the real game wood.
We have men here who have murdered in the community on the basis of serious mental illness, acting out that mental illness, who are still mentally ill and despite all known forms of psychiatric treatment are mentally ill and will kill again. There's the criminally insane. These are the men who've come from the prisons, their age from their early 20s to early 70s. And they were in jail because they'd murdered or alleged to have done so. Committed grievous bodily harm or malicious wounding crimes or sexual mutilation. Two have murdered because of the belief that close relatives were poisoning them. One worships the sun, another says he's owed several millions for film appearances.
And how are you today, George?
I'm not happy, Mr. Michael.
You're not happy?
No, Mr. Michael.
Why is that?
Mr. Michael, the doctor, the one who she who sat under the near the tree with you. He punished me years ago on the needles and on the tablets.
Did he?
Beside him, the patients, they're all my enemies. They fight me every day, Mr. Mark.
Well, I was in H Division for approximately about 5 months. And during that period of time, my mind started to go.
Because I was in H Division
in solitary confinement, not allowed to talk to anybody or see anybody. You brought out to yourselves a single, one at a time, I should say. And I had a bash, being bashed down there by battens, by a couple of the officers. And I begged one of the officers in the end to shoot me. He put the gun through my cell late at night. And I sang out to him and asked him to pull the trigger, and he wouldn't pull the trigger. This was because I just couldn't stand any more of the bashings and that was going on.
Do you think that's why you ended up here?
Yes, I do, yes. Yeah. It wouldn't have happened otherwise.
Now, from an appearance point of view, he was a small man, a pretty unremarkable looking man, really, but he had a lot of power. We were always looking at ways to try and occupy him in such a way that didn't revolve around plotting people's destruction and organising the other guys. Because he had sort of, no matter how bad the crim mentality, they were always very wary of Gary. But yeah, I had several totally normal chats that usually revolved around music because he was interested and we had a mutual interest in that field that I never allowed them to go beyond those sort of comments, though, because then you start getting situations where you might get threats made on your kids, and which happened to a couple of other staff members. So we thought if we can do something with him that was, a bit more likely to take his mind off that stuff, we would. And he approached us about whether we could have guitar lessons, because he was quite an accomplished musician. And it took us a few weeks to convince the older members of the ward that it was a safe thing. And whilst I shared their concerns, me and a couple of other guys that supervised the sessions were confident that our security measures were sufficient and it would outweigh the dangers. And as it was, it was quite successful. And he did thank me for organising that, and he said to me, you know, Gavin, you're a good bloke. When I get out of this joint, I'll shoot you last. The main one I can remember was blowing up the MCG on grand final day. Yeah, I've got no question he would have done that had he been able to get a hold of the necessary materials. I was absolutely thrilled that he wouldn't get out, because I have no doubts that if he ever got out, he would have enacted.
Treatments include antipsychotic drugs and occasionally electroconvulsive therapy. Patients may be forced to undergo treatments which, according to management, reduce life-threatening situations and profound suffering. They certainly assist management, but patients sometimes have other views.
I've never been so worse than all. Never been so bad off in all my life when I've been having drugs as what I have been when I'm normal. I can't understand it. It's unbelievable, the drugs.
They don't quieten you at all?
They don't quieten me, no. They make me lay down and sleep, but I can't keep still for 1 minute, you know. It's very hard to explain how I've tried to explain it to the doctor, but this fluoroquinolone or Modocate, whatever they call it. I just can't take it. I'd sooner be dead than have Modocate injections.
Thank you, Dad. Now, we'll have a hymn now. Les Wanted Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages, left for me.
Jay Ward has become more a part of the Ararat community and draws on some of the town's facilities. Today it's a church service with Father Ian Herring, held in a three-man cell converted into a tiny chapel.
We had a lot of people arriving from the criminal justice system, say from Pentridge. A lot of people were delivered from other hospitals. Some people were picked up on the street, habitually committing crimes that would never face the court. The thing is here is it was a holding situation, as you know, for maximum security, for people that could not be handled or trusted in a public area, or even in another normal hospital. As far as treatment was concerned, as I said before, you're monitoring these people, you're trying to move them on. You haven't got a long-term treatment establishment. You're trying to move those people away from the establishment. So they're in here, some of them very short-term, before you move them on for different treatment in another hospital environment. Quite a percentage of people that come into J Ward, the staff regard it as, well, why is this person here? In which case, those people are out of their comfort area. You try to help them, you try to turn them around and monitor them from day to day and move them out of the system, because those people you felt were pretty helpless in this situation. We had a few returnees that would come back, especially one or two fellows from Pentridge that would get sick in jail and then come up here for a while, and then 18 months later they might be around again. In a place like this, I think you keep your eye on everybody. If you've got a quiet patient sitting around for a week or two at a time, depending on his background, is he going to stay this way, or is he going to come to a point where he's going to blow a fuse and cause some problems? If you've got someone with an aggressive nature, and you say you're out on the exercise yard, you're keeping an eye on this person most of the day, that he doesn't get tangled up with other patients and cause problems. You've always got somebody under the gun that have got more potential than others as far as your area is concerned. You're aware of, well, when you come in, you're aware of those sort of things. And if you join in staff here, as a new staff member especially, you'll soon put wise as to who to keep an eye on through the day, what their mannerisms were and attitude generally to staff. This is what you keep an eye on. The hardliners we had here, of course, quite a few come up and down from Pentridge. One or two from other mental hospitals. We had one or two from our main hospital that would come here on a fairly regular basis. There wasn't much reading material here for people. You had to regard most things as something lethal. Somebody with paperwork in their hands could use that to suffocate. I can't remember anybody on the exercise yard even reading anything through the day. If you sat in the dining room and you let people read something, you'd be monitoring one-on-one. You'd help people write letters, that'd be a bit different. But and then in later years, of course, we had a TV set up in the day room. I like one young fella come through with his family and went up to the middle of the cell block, and he pointed to a cell and said, "I slept in that cell." Now that's an indication of people that have come through the system in a harsh environment, gone on to another mental hospital, come back out in society again and really picked themselves up and improved the situation. So the system has done something for them. I think a lot of the time I was here, it was a pretty docile environment. You had your certain days when you come on duty where the atmosphere was a bit different, and then you just watch each other's backs on those sort of days, because you never knew that if any trouble was brewing. But normally it was pretty good in my time anyway. I can't imagine back in the 1800s and later years, you know, in between our time, that it might have been entirely different. But I found it here, well, a good place to work. I like working with people, which is why I was in the mental health system anyway. But it was, many of the days were good.
Well, for a start, the pleasure of spending an hour, well, not so much the pleasure of spending an hour, but you spend an hour with a depressed patient, and after an hour, that patient walks away and he's reasonably settled again. That, to my idea, is pleasure. Canteen days is another thing. When they receive their small canteen parcels, the numbers of offers of cigarettes and lollies, and this is real pleasure, it's contentment in my book. One very bad frustration amongst all the staff, particularly as the fact that J Ward is classed as the end of the journey.
George is a Greek Cypriot who came to us after having murdered a fellow Cypriot. Apparently, some 20 years ago, he murdered this gentleman after this gentleman had made homosexual advances towards him. Since he's been, he has attempted to cut another person's throat. He has quite fixed delusions. They're extremely fixed at the fact that he is a member of the royal family, in fact, married to him. And he seems to think that the situation is that they will eventually come and collect him and take him back home to England.
I cannot see Princess Margaret with my royal family, but I'm sure my Princess Margaret and my royal family, they look after me.
I guess it was just one of those things. There were certain aspects of it. Security aspects probably could have been a little bit more acute. But no, given the nature of the guy's condition, it was something that could have happened at any time. Usually, though, he never had a knife whilst it was happening. Started the shift at 7 o'clock, and about 2:30 in the afternoon, I got stabbed by one of the inmates during a visit from his mother. He had a condition known as catatonic schizophrenia. Now, some of your viewers might understand the word catatonic to usually mean a state, a fugue state where the person's still, but it's actually a type of schizophrenia where you've got that state or a complete excitement state. And Robert was in a state of catatonic excitement, it's my belief. And I would think that he may not even have known I was there or had no recollection of doing it. But I'm quite satisfied to believe that because I actually had quite a rapport with him. Our structure being a charge nurse, a deputy charge nurse in charge of medication and inside, and a deputy charge nurse in charge of the yard, clients and the other staff, of which that was my capacity that day. Well, about, quarter past two, the other deputy charge nurse came out to say, Gavin, go and have a cuppa, which we did just as our afternoon tea. It was a relief that the deputy inside would relieve me. And I just went into the cell block and Robert was running at me. Yeah, now I can remember it vividly because I needed to function, I guess just the old fight or flight thing, and I managed to respond. By the time he had reached me, I'd got past the cell block and into the visiting area, where then I quickly thought, well, this guy's coming at me, I'm going to have to move out of the way and push him into the cell block. Because had I been able to do that, I could then isolate him by locking it. So he came at me and I didn't even realise I'd been stabbed. He grazed the salt my side, but in this time I'd managed to push him into the cell block, lock it on my knees and yell out to the guys outside, don't come in. So, and he actually ran around, just sort of stabbing the walls and that for about an hour and a half. And then he was subdued with a security blanket and placed in his cell, but nobody approached him until he'd started to settle. So it was only another staff member that said, he must have got you. Because about 2 hours later, there was blood seeping through my shirt. I guess because of the lack of nerve endings in that area, I actually felt no pain. Didn't feel anything. An x-ray later revealed I actually had a chip taken out of a rib. So probably from that point of view, I was probably fortunate, yes. No, I had no ill feeling because I was totally satisfied with my belief of his diagnosis. I believe the psychiatrists were right. And Robert used to regularly lose it and start punching at everybody about once a fortnight when he required six staff to place him in his cell. And he was quite a little man. But the thing about this incident was that he actually had a knife at the time, and that was what elevated it beyond its normal state.
The fact that J Ward has a high staff patient ratio enables us to prevent injury and accident in many instances, such as the possibility of attacks on other people, on people generally, and the possibility of suicide, which we've done fairly recently by the finding of a noose that was made, fashioned out of a mattress cover, and then we make sure, if we can, that that same situation doesn't occur again.
How do you do that?
Usually by, if a fellow was likely to hang himself in his room, remove the bedding and leave him with an absolute minimum of bedding. Or sufficiently to keep him warm, but hard, difficult things to fashion suicide implements with.
Well, what do these other implements represent?
Well, there's an escape method. A brick tied onto an old bag, a sharpened toothbrush, implements from the plumbing around the place, and parts of furniture. That collection there has been attempted suicide.
In spite of the need for security, attempts are being made to make some cells look like bedrooms, with carpet and curtains and soon portable lavatories.
Also in H Division, and I was sent from H Division to G Division in a pretty bad sort of a state, and I was sent here to J Ward in a very poorly condition, more or less like a vegetable. I myself was told by the CMA that I was never mentally insane, but I was here because I withdrew into myself.
That he existed until probably, I don't know, mid-70s, early 80s. Wasn't talked about in the family, so, perhaps we vaguely knew that he existed, but we didn't pursue it or anything. Well, it must have been after his death, 1950. He died in 1950. Like a lot of people, we didn't have a car, so we got the neighbour to drive us up here. There was me, my father, and my mother. We came to Ararat. I just thought it was, just a day out or whatever. And then my mother insisted that I stay down the street. So we went to some cafe or something. So my father disappeared with the neighbour who drove us up, and I only found this out 30 years later. This is probably the mid-80s. I always struggle to think about when I actually did or make the connection. But I do remember that trip to Ararat, and I asked the neighbour, and he confirmed that, yeah, they'd went to the cemetery, Ararat Cemetery, to see his grave. And yeah, I don't know quite why, but I saw there was an open day at J Ward in 1993. J Ward itself had closed 2 years earlier, so I thought there must be a file on him, so I thought, well, I better get in perhaps before the file is thrown out or destroyed. That's when I wrote away to the archivist. The committal papers were signed by his father. There was three ways of being committed, apparently. There was you could voluntarily put yourself in, or you could have a court case where you assaulted someone or whatever, and the court could sentence you to go to a mental asylum, as it was called then, or else there was a private bequest. And it was, to our astonishment, we found out it was a private bequest, because we always thought there'd been a court case. And that's how he came to be here. But no, it was a request signed by, the papers were signed by his father. So at 16, he was obviously proving a handful, and so he was sent down to Sunnyside. And he was there for 3.5 years. Then went to Kew at Willsmere for 2 months and then came up here. He came first to Arredale, though, actually, and then to J Ward. The reports do refer to him insulting his father. I don't know if any court cases arose out of that. But I would have thought, yeah, his father probably had him committed because he was probably uncontrollable. You know, he's very angry, certainly very angry. Probably he thought, I just can't handle him. So, but again, how he come to be J Ward? Because it is for the criminally insane, and there's nothing. Well, there's no criminal case, as far as I know. He obviously did write to my father from time to time, wanting to be let out. But there's a letter there, 1933, which is 17 years before he died, my father writing to the medical director here, or the superintendent, saying that he writes a good letter, and he's, you know, his grammar's very good, and he doesn't, he had a lot of trouble with his temper when he was young, but now he seems to be okay. He couldn't see any reason why he shouldn't be released. But then the superintendent or whatever wrote back and said, you've made the suggestion that he should be released, but you've made no other suggestions about how this was going to be achieved. In other words, him living with you or whatever. 30 years later, they still make the same remarks about being extremely lazy and has not done any work for 30 to 40 years. But he has, quite a logical answer to that. He says, I'm not being paid for it. He says, outside, I would work because I'd be paid for it. Yeah, there probably would have been a lot of other letters, certainly from the 1930s onwards. There is some references to him getting into fights because he does seem to be obsessed with physical strength. And there's that classic boast of him, you know, saying he was the strongest man in the world. In 1912, you know, he wanted to fight Jack Johnson, who was the heavyweight champion of the world at that time. By 1940, he wants to fight Joe Louis, who was the heavyweight champion of the world. I think it's just the circumstances of his life. It just seemed rather saddened. And you just wondered why, you know, somebody could spend, you know, 40 years here. Sad life. Oh, perhaps even stronger word is where. It'd be one word, injustice. No, I don't need two. Yeah, one, injustice.